Good morning everyone, welcome back to analysis of indeterminate structures. In this particular session, we are going to solve one simple continuous beam subjected to point load and uniformly distributed load by using flexibility matrix approach. Yes, to simplify the procedure, the entire solution of this particular problem has been divided into sub-steps. Clear? If you follow those simple steps, we can easily understand and remember the solution. Before analyzing this particular continuous beam, I'll just brief out the steps. We have to follow four simple steps here. In step number one, we are going to find degree of static indeterminacy. And based on that, we assume the redundance and we mark the general coordinate directions. In step number two, we are going to sketch the bending moment diagram for the released determinate structure. After that, we are going to sketch M by EI diagram by using the concepts of conjugate beam. In step number three, we are going to use simple flexibility relation, that is D equals to F into P, and we are going to find the individual elements there. We are going to find out DL, that is displacement due to loading, and we are going to find out F, that is flexibility matrix. Inside the flexibility matrix, based upon the size of the matrix, we should find the elements like F11, F12, clear? Then the P matrix is the force matrix. There we are going to find out the unknown forces, which may be in the form of moments or in the form of reactions. And lastly, in step number four, we are going to sketch the shear force diagram and the bending moment diagram after marking the final end moments for the given beam. Clear? So let us follow all these steps one by one to get the solution. The very first step is, already I told you, we find the degree of static indeterminacy. The degree of static indeterminacy is represented by DSI, and you all know this DSI can be found by using the relation number of unknown forces in the given beam minus number of known equilibrium conditions. If you observe the given beam, the number of unknown forces at A will be 2. Since at A we have fixed support, for fixed supports we have one vertical reaction and one moment. Yes, in case of beams we neglect axial deformations. So B is the intermediate support and it is considered as continuous. There we have one vertical reaction, and at C it's a roller support, again we have one vertical reaction. So if you count it, it's 1, 2, 3 and 4. The number of unknown forces will be 4. And in case of beams, the number of known equilibrium conditions are 2. One is moment equilibrium and another one is vertical force equilibrium. So if you solve this, you are going to get the degree of static indeterminacy as 2. So I can say this beam is indeterminate to degree 2. So now, after getting this degree of static indeterminacy, based on this number, we should assume or we should mark the redundance. Again, redundance are nothing but the unknown forces in the given structure. If you observe the structure, the unknown forces will be in the form of moment or in the form of reactions. Clear? So, if you take point A, you have RA and moment MAB. If you take support B, you have reaction RB and the moments MBA and MBC. Since B is a middle support, we have two moments there, and those two moments are equal and opposite to fulfill the moment equilibrium, that is joint equilibrium. Clear? And at C, you have reaction RC and moment MCB. And you all know, since C is a simple support, moment MCB will be equals to 0. So you can assume the moments as redundants or reactions as redundants. In this particular problem, I am going to take moments at A and B as redundants. Therefore, redundants will be taken as MAB. We should take two redundants and MBA. Either you can take MBA or MBC, because both MBA and MBC are same. So, after marking redundants, we should write the released structure. So, what is the released structure? So, released structure will be like this. Since B is a common support, we should show B for both the span, that is span AB and span BC. It is 10 kilonewton per meter and this is 60 kilonewton. This is A, this is B, this is also B, this is C. It's having same span. Here, this is a release structure. Here, I should mark the redundants. Here, so one redundant we have taken it as MAB and another one is MBA or MBC. This is MBA and this is MBC. Clear? So now you can see the release structure will be of two determinate beams. So if you look into span AB, this is a determinate one and BC also determinate structure. Next, along the directions of redundants, we should mark the general coordinates. We require these general coordinates to proceed further. So, again for both the span, span AB and for span BC, we are going to mark the general coordinate directions. Again, these general coordinates, that means number of general coordinates, depends upon degree of static indeterminacy. Since we have got 2 degree of static indeterminacy, here also we should mark 2 general coordinates. Number 1 will be marked along MAB, number 2 will be marked along MBA and MBC. So this is called figure C and we call this as general coordinate directions. So this completes step number 1. So step number 1 involves the calculation of DSI, that is degree of static indeterminacy. Based on this, we mark the redundants, then we mark the general coordinate directions. Moving further, let us take step number 2. I already told you, in step number 2, we are going to sketch the bending moment diagram. Yes, now we should draw bending moment diagram for figure B. So, we should take these two spans as reference. For this loading conditions, we are going to sketch bending moment diagram. Let us see. See, span AB is subjected to point load of magnitude 60 kN and point BC is subjected to uniformly distributed load of intensity 10 kN per meter. And you know the basic concepts of bending moment diagram. If you have point load, the variation will be linear, and if you have UDL, the variation will be parabolic. So let us draw the bending moment diagram for span AB first. Span AB is having 6 meter span. So at A and at B, since the supports are simple, the bending moment will be 0. Since the given loading pattern is symmetrical, so we get triangular loading pattern like this, and this can be found out by using the formula WL by 4. So you know W is 60 and L is 6 divided by 4. So that gives you 90 kilonewton meter. and this is positive bending moment. The maximum moment at the center will be 90 kilonewton meter. Next, if you repeat the same procedure for span BC, again B and C are simple support, therefore bending moment at B and C are zero and it is subjected to UDL. So the variation of bending moment will be parabola and the maximum moment will be at the center, and that value can be found by using the relation WL square by 8. So W is 10 and L is 6, 10 into 6 square divided by 8, if you solve, you will get 45 kilonewton meter. Again, the bending moment will be in positive sense. So this is BMD for the released structure. We call this as figure D. Now, by using the basic concepts of conjugate beam method, we write the M by EI diagram. So what are the basic concepts we require here? So very first is support conditions. We treat this figure B, that is released structure, as real beam. So in real beam, we have simple supports. So in conjugate beam also, we'll get simple supports. Clear? So when we have simple supports in the real beam, in conjugate beam also, we'll get the simple supports. Clear? Second one is about the span. Span remains as it is. If you are having 6 meters in the real beam, in conjugate beam also we'll get 6 meters. So these two are the basic required points. So let us write the conjugate beam now. So I've already told you, whatever the span in real beam, in conjugate beam also span remains as it is. So 6 meters, 6 meters. And in real beam, refer figure B, we have simple supports. Therefore, here also we'll get simple supports. Just to differentiate the real beam and conjugate beam, I'll mark in conjugate beam as A dash, B dash, B dash and C dash. Clear? So now, the last requirement is loading. Whatever the bending moment diagram we have sketched, that BMD will be the loading for conjugate beam. So this triangular portion will be the loading for conjugate beam along with EI. Therefore, bending moment value divided by EI gives you the M by EI diagram. So this is 90 divided by EI. Clear? Since we have positive bending moment, the loading will be in downward direction. If you get negative bending moment, the loading will be in upward direction. That is the only change. So we make use of this BMD as loading on conjugate beam. Bending moment superimposed on EI diagram gives us M by EI diagram. That M by EI diagram acts as loading for conjugate beam. So now for span B dash, C dash, it is a parabolic loading. Again, here also, since the bending moment is positive sense, we have downward loading. So this is 45 by EI. So in problem, if they give variation of EI, so you should take that variation here. For example, in some problems, they give span AB as 2 EI, span BC as 1.5 EI. Clear? That means the variation of I, moment of inertia, that you have to consider here. Here, the EI value is constant. Therefore, it is just 90 by EI and 45 by EI. This is called figure E. And the name is conjugate beam. So this completes the step number 2. In step number 2, we sketch bending moment diagram and conjugate beam. We just need the basic concepts of conjugate beam here about support condition, span and loads. The bending moment diagram superimposed on EI diagram gives us M by EI diagram, and that will be act as load for conjugate beam. So now in step number 3, we take flexibility matrix relationship, which is given by D equals to F into P, and this D can be written as D minus DL, DL equals to F into P. Call this as equation A, and you all know this D matrix represents displacement, F represents flexibility, and P represents force matrix. Clear? And always remember, D matrix and P matrix are column matrices, and F is always a square matrix. Clear? So, and the order, that means the size of all these matrices, depends upon this degree of static indeterminacy. Therefore, this step, this calculation is very, very important. Clear? So now we get all these factors one by one. First, we'll find this displacement matrix, that is DL. So what is this DL? DL gives us the corresponding displacements at the coordinates 1 and 2 due to the externally applied loadings. Clear? So we can write this DL as, I've already told you, this is a column matrix of order 2 cross 1. 2 represents number of rows and 1 represents number of columns. You can write it as D1L and D2L. D1L is the displacement at coordinate number 1 due to loading, and D2 is the displacement at coordinate number 2 due to loading. When I say displacement, you can get the displacement either in the form of theta or delta. Here, since we have assumed moments as redundants, we should take theta as the displacement. Therefore, here at coordinate number 1, I can get theta A, and at coordinate number 2, I'll get theta B as the displacement. Clear? So now, by using the theorem of conjugate beam, it's theorem 1. If you want to get the slope in the real beam, we should find the shear force in the conjugate beam. So I want slope at A, therefore I should find shear force at A dash. So if you observe figure E, what is the shear force at A dash? It is the reaction RA dash. And here this RB dash, here also you'll get RB dash, and this is RC dash. Clear? Therefore, theta is the shear force at A dash, and that is also equals to RA dash. Next, if I want theta B, it is the shear force at B dash. When I say B dash is common to both the spans, AB dash and B dash and C dash. Therefore, I should get the RB dash from both the spans. Clear? So that's why the shear force at B dash will be RB dash plus RB dash. So one from the span A dash, B dash, and another from the span B dash and C dash. So now if you look into this equation, it is very simple. So if you get the values of these reactions, you can find theta A and theta B easily. That means they are equal. RA dash equals to theta A and RB dash equals to theta B. How we got this relation? This is based on theorem number 1 in conjugate beam. If you want slope in real beams, we need to find the shear force in conjugate beams. Clear? So now, how to find these reactions? We should apply moment equilibrium conditions to get the reactions. Look at the loading. Since in this particular beam, the loading is symmetrical, we can easily find the reactions by using simple relationship like RA dash equals to RB dash equals to total load divided by 2. So total load divided by 2. What is the total load here? It is a triangular one. Therefore, the total load will be half into base into height, the maximum intensity, divided by 2. If you solve this, you will get 135 by EI. Take the next span B dash and C dash. Here also, since the loading is symmetrical, you can use the same logic. RB dash equals to RC dash equals to, what is the total load here? It's a parabolic one. Therefore, 2 by 3 into base into height is 45 by EI divided by 2. And again, if you solve this, it is 90 by EI. Clear? So, these are the reactions for the given conjugate beam. So, now let us see theta A equals to RA dash. So, we got the RA dash value as 135. Therefore, theta A is 135 by EI. Next, theta B equals to shear force at RB dash, that is shear force at B dash, that is RB dash for span A dash B dash. RB dash for the span A dash B dash and RB dash for the span B dash and C dash. So, for the first span it is 135 by EI, for the second span it is 90 by EI. So, if you sum up these two, 135 by EI plus 90 by EI, we'll get 225 by EI. So, we got both theta A and theta B. In both theta A and theta B, we have 1 by EI as common. Take it outside. So, we have 135 and 225. Therefore, D1L is 135 and D2L is 225. So, this is how we can get the displacement matrix. If you don't have symmetrical loading, here you can use the moment equilibrium conditions and force equilibrium conditions to get the reactions. Our next step is to find the flexibility coefficients. Yes, look at this equation. It's a flexibility matrix relationship. In this, we have got displacement matrix, that is DL, because of the loading. Next, we need to find this flexibility matrix. Yes, I've already told you the order, I mean the size of all these matrices depends upon the degree of static indeterminacies, and this D and P matrices or column matrices, and this F matrix is a square matrix. So this F matrix for this particular problem is of order 2 cross 2, and we have the coefficients like F11, F21, F12 and F22. These are the flexibility coefficients, and we should find these coefficients one by one. And as of course we find these coefficients in column wise, these two comes under column number 1 and these two elements comes under column number 2. And if I take Fij, general flexibility coefficient, here ith place represent displacement and the jth position represents the force. To get these coefficients, we take the released beam and we remove all the externally applied loading, and we are going to just apply the unit force at coordinate number 1 and also at coordinate number 2, and we check the displacement respectively at coordinate number 1 and 2. Clear? So, to find the first column elements, we should apply unit moment at coordinate number 1. And we should check the displacement at coordinates 1 and 2 respectively. For this, we are going to write the released structure without externally applied loading. We have span AB and BC of span 6 meters and 6 meters. I'll take off all the load like point load and UDL. And I'm going to just apply the unit moment at coordinate number 1. We all know we have marked the coordinate number 1 at this position. And this is the coordinate number 1. This will be equal to 1 kilonewton meter. Clear? Therefore, this is called as figure F. This is a real beam. Now, keeping this beam as reference, we are again going to sketch the bending moment diagram, then M by EI diagram as loading for conjugate beam. So, if you see, the bending moment diagram for these two spans will be, I have 1 kilonewton meter here moment, which is marked in the upward direction. Therefore, I have 1 kilonewton meter here. And at B, I don't get any sort of moment. Therefore, the moment at B will be equals to 0. And if you take the second span, BC, moments at B and C will be equals to 0. And yes, I am going to load this bending moment diagram on EI diagram. Since I have got positive bending moment, the loading will be in downward direction. And this intensity is 1 by EI. And in real beam, I have simple supports. Therefore, if I load this diagram on a conjugate beam, the conjugate beam also have simple supports. And the span in the conjugate beam is also the same. Here, I'm just avoiding one step. I'm not writing bending moment diagram separately. Clear? I'm just showing you the M by EI diagram directly. Clear? So this is called, just to make a difference for real beam and conjugate beam, I'm marking these positions as A dash, B dash, B dash and C dash. Call this as figure G, and this is the conjugate beam. Yes, of course, again, we need reactions to solve the problem further. And I mark these reactions as RA dash, RB dash, here also it is RB dash, and here it is RC dash. Clear? By keeping this diagram as reference, that is conjugate beam, we can find the reactions. Now, let us see the first column elements F11 and F22. F11 means what? It is the rotation at coordinate 1 due to unit moment at coordinate 1 itself. That's why we have got 1, 1, F11. Clear? And this is equals to theta A. And go back to the theorem in conjugate beam. If you want theta A, I need to find the shear force at A dash. What is the shear force at A dash? It is R A dash. So this is equals to shear force at A dash. And this equals to R A dash. Now we are using figure G. So while finding DL matrix also, we are make use of conjugate beam. But the loading condition was different. Here the loading condition is different. So now, if you want F21, what is F21? See, I've already written here, ith position represents the displacement, jth position represents the force. Displacement, force. 2 is the displacement, 1 is the force. So this is the rotation. See, we have applied the moment only at coordinate number 1 and we are checking the displacement at 1 and 2. 1 will be at A dash and 2 will be at B dash. Rotation at coordinate number 2 due to unit moment at coordinate 1. So, what is the rotation at coordinate number 2? It is theta b. So, to find theta b, we need to find the shear force at b dash. So, what is the shear force at b dash? It is rb dash. But, we have rb dash twice here. One for span a dash b dash and another for span b dash and c dash. Therefore, we should write rb dash plus rb dash. If you want, for your reference, you can write the span naming. Now let us find the reactions here. Look at this diagram. This is a triangular loading. The entire loading of this triangle will be acts at the centroid. Clear? And what is this W? This is half into base is 6 and height is 1 by EI. If I solve this, I'll get 3 by EI. To simplify the procedure, to get RA dash, see, this is base and this is apex. If I have reactions at base, I should multiply the factor called 2 by 3 and at apex, I multiply the factor 1 by 3. Clear? This is just a simplified version, or else you can apply equilibrium conditions to get the reactions. Look here. So, RA dash will be equals to, the total load is 3 by I multiplied by, this is the base point, therefore 2 by 3. If I want RB dash, the total load is 3 by EI and this is situated at the apex point, therefore I'll multiply the factor 1 by 3. If you simplify this, I'll get 2 by EI and here I'll get 1 by EI. This is for span, first span A dash and B dash. For the second span, we don't have any kind of loading. Therefore, RB dash equals to 0 and RC dash is also equals to 0. Once we got these reactions, next we need to substitute the values in the respective positions. Clear? So, RA dash is 2 by EI. RB dash is 1 by EI plus 0. And the total value will be equals to 1 by EI. This is how we'll get the flexibility coefficients. This is all about the first column elements. This is just a repetition. We did the same steps while finding the elements in DL matrix. Now, to get the second column elements, F12 and F22, we should follow the same procedure. Let us see how to get the second column elements in flexibility matrix. So, look here, to find the second column elements, that is F12 and F22, we should apply unit moment at coordinate number 2 and check the displacement at 1 and 2. So, where we have coordinate number 2? The coordinate number 2 will be at point B. So, this is coordinate number 2. At this position, we need to apply unit moment, 1 kilonewton meter. Now, by keeping this beam as reference, we need to sketch BMD. Then we have to load that BMD on EI diagram, we'll get M by EI diagram. So that will be the loading for conjugate beam. So you all know how to write the conjugate beam. So we are just repeating the procedure. So the span will be the same. And the support is also the same. In real beam, we have simple support. Therefore, in conjugate beam also, we'll get the simple support. This is B dash, and this is C dash. And the span is 6 meters. Here also it is 6 meters. If you write the bending moment, see, we have 1 kilonewton meter at B dash, because the moment is acting in upward direction. Therefore, I'll mark the intensity, value of moment in upward direction. And here at A dash, the moment value is 0. Join these two points. Again, in span B dash, C dash also, 1 kilonewton meter is acting in upward direction. Therefore, I'll mark the intensity in upward direction. Again, at C dash, the moment is 0. Join these two points. We get the loading pattern like this. Since the moment is in positive sense, the loading will be in downward direction on conjugate beam. And this intensity will be 1 by EI. Moment is 1 and that is superimposed on EI diagram. Therefore, it will become 1 by EI for both the loading diagram. So now, as usual, these are the reactions RA dash, RB dash. This is also RB dash, and this is RC dash. And this diagram is called as conjugate beam. Now, by keeping this beam as reference, we are going to find the reactions. Now, look here. The elements F1, 2 is nothing but rotation at coordinate number 1 due to unit moment at coordinate 2. And F2, 2 is the rotation at coordinate number 2 due to unit moment at coordinate number 2. In previous step, we have applied unit moment at 1 and we checked the displacements at 1 and 2. And here, we applied the unit moment at 2 and we checked the displacement at 1 and 2. So now, F1, 2 is equals to theta A. That means displacement at 1 will be theta A. And if you want theta A, we should find the shear force at A dash. Shear force at A dash is nothing but the reaction, RA dash. In the same manner, we want F2, 2 is equals to theta B. And this theta B is equals to shear force at B dash. And this will be equals to reactions developed at B dash, that is RB dash. Since we have two supports at B dash, clear? Because B dash is a common support. Therefore, we get RB dash and RB dash for both the spans. Now, as usual, calculate the reactions. Here also, the load acts at the centroid and we call that load as W. Since the intensity and the span is same for both the loadings, we get W equals to half into base into height, 1 by EI equals to 3 by EI. It is not mandatory to get the same loading for both the span. In this problem, we are getting, that's it, clear? So 3 by EI. So now, as usual, if you want RA dash is at the apex point. Therefore, the total loading 3 by EI into 1 by 3 gives you RA dash. Then RB dash will be at the base point. Therefore, total loading 3 by EI into 2 by 3 gives you RB dash. And if you take out the second span, RB dash equals to, again it is at the base. Therefore, it is 3 by EI total loading into the factor 2 by 3. And RC dash is at the apex. It is 3 by EI into 1 by 3. We don't require RC dash, but still I'm just doing the calculation. Clear? So if you solve all these things, it is 1 by EI and this is 2 by EI and here it is 2 by EI and here you will get 1 by EI. Once you got the reactions, just substitute them in the respective positions. So RA dash is 1 by EI and RB dash from both the spans, 2 by EI and 2 by EI, if you sum it up, you'll get 4 by EI. So like this, we can get the flexibility matrix. So now just substitute all the elements at the respective positions, you get F matrix. So let us substitute the values of F. So in all the elements, I have 1 by EI common, therefore I take it out. F11 is 2 and F21 is 1 and F12 is 1 and F22 is 4. So these are the values for F matrix. So we are done with the calculation of f. Now if you observe equation A, we left with D and P. We should consider this D only when we get sinking supports or some rotations at the supports, or else this D should be treated as zero. And P matrix represents the force matrix, that is MAB and MBA. We have kept MAB and MBA as unknowns. Clear? So now let us substitute all the values for this particular equation. So we know D matrix is 0 here. Therefore, 0 minus, you all know DL matrix is given by 1 by EI. It's a column matrix, into first loading is 135 and 225. Then F matrix we already written here, it is 1 by EI into 2, 1, 1 and 4. And P, you can write it as P1 and P2 or MAB or MBA. Clear? So I'll just write it as P1 and P2. If you simplify this, EI and EI gets cancelled. This minus sign get into inside, it is minus 135 minus 225, that equals to 2114, and this is P1 and P2. To get P1 and P2, send this matrix to this side. Clear? So this will become 1 minus 135 minus 225 divided by this matrix. So we should take the inverse of this matrix. By taking the inverse of this square matrix, we'll get P1 and P2 equals to, we'll get 4, 2, minus 1, minus 1 divided by 7. This is the determinant multiplied by minus 135 and minus 225. You can easily solve this equation by using calculator, or you all know the basic matrix approach to solve this type of equation. Just taken the determinant here, 2 4s are 8, 8 minus 1 is 7. Then you have to interchange this principal diagonal elements, 4 and 2. You have to give the negative sign for these elements. Clear? And finally, if you do the matrix multiplication, you get the values of P1 and P2 as, for this I'll show the matrix multiplication. It is 1 by 7 into C. We multiply row into column. First row into first column, second row into first column. Because P is the column matrix, you get the size as 2 cross 1. It is 4 into minus 135 plus minus 1 into minus 225. Then minus 1 into minus 135 plus 2 into minus 225. So if you solve this, we get P1 and P2 as, this P1 is MAB and this P2 is MBA or MBC. The final answers are minus 45 and minus 45. Here. So this completes the step number 3. So from here, after substituting the values, easily with the help of calculator, you can get the final answer, or else you just do the simple mathematical operations to get the final answers. Clear? Manually also you can solve. It is very easy to solve manually if you get 2 cross 2 size. If it is 3 cross 3, the procedure will be tedious. Therefore, you can make use of calculator. So now, After getting this final answers, that is P1 and P2, MAB and MBA or MBC, we should mark these moments. So these are the moments. We should mark these moments on the given structure. So these are our final end moments. So let us mark these moments. MAB is minus 45. Therefore, minus means anti-clockwise, 45 kilonewton meter. And MBA is minus 45, but here we should mark like this because MBA and MBC both are equal and opposite. That's why if this is in anti-clockwise direction, this should be in clockwise direction. Therefore, we'll mark like this, 45 kilonewton meter. Clear? Because we have marked the coordinate 2 at B. Since B is an intermediate support, we have two moments there, BA and BC. One should be clockwise and another should be anticlockwise. Why I have taken BA as clockwise? Because you observe the general coordinate directions. In general coordinate directions, we have marked the coordinate directions like this. Clear? Since I have got the negative answer there, I need to just change the directions like this. Here I have taken anticlockwise, I should write it in clockwise manner. Here I have taken clockwise, I should mark it in anticlockwise manner. Now, the last step is to draw shear force diagram and bending moment diagram. So after marking the final end moments on the given structure, we should find the reactions and we should find the moments at some defined points. Let us do that first. We have reactions at point A and point B and at point C. Let us call this as RA, RB and RC. And you all know, since C is a simple support, the bending moment at C will be equals to zero. Now, to find the reactions, we should take the spans individually. First, I'll consider span AB and I'll write the free body diagram of span AB. Span AB will be like this, subjected to 16 kilonewton point load, having span 6 meters. And this is called RA and this is called RBA. Since B is a common support, I'll split the reaction into two components, RBA and RBC. Now, at A, I have moment 45 kilonewton meter acting in anticlockwise direction, and at B I have one more moment 45 kilonewton meter acting in clockwise direction, and I call this point as P. Now just apply, if the beam is symmetrical, that means the loading and geometry is symmetrical, you can easily use the same logic, that is to find the reactions, total load divided by 2, or else you can make use of moment equilibrium conditions and also the force equilibrium condition. Here, since the loading is symmetrical, I just use RA equals to RBA equals to the total load. The total load is 60. 60 divided by 2, I'll get 30 kilonewton as the reaction value. Next, take span BC. If I write the free body diagram for span BC, it is subjected to UDL of intensity 10 kilonewton per meter and having the span 6 meters. And if you look at the given beam, the moment at B point is 45 kilonewton meter acting in anticlockwise direction, and at C it is 0. And the reaction at B support will be RBC and at C support it is RC. Since B is an intermediate support, as already told, we have split the B into two components, RBA and RBC. Clear? So now, look at the diagram. It is unsymmetrical. Therefore, we can't use this logic. We should use the equilibrium conditions. If you use the equilibrium condition, take MB equals to summation of all the moments about B equals to 0, and I'll take clockwise moment as positive. If you apply this condition, minus RC into 6, then plus 10 into 6 into 6 by 2, then minus 45, and this is 0, this equals to 0. If you solve this, you'll get the value of RC as 22.5 kilonewton. Another equilibrium condition is force equilibrium, summation of all the vertical forces equals to zero, upward forces as positive. Taking this sign convention, upward forces as positive, I have RBC plus RC minus this UDL is acting in downward direction, 10 into 6, this equals to 0. You should take only the forces here, and if you apply the value of RC and if you solve this equation, you'll get the value for RBC as 37.5 kilonewton. Once we got the reactions, we can draw the shear force diagram. So let us draw the shear force diagram. As usual, take the reference lines just like this. You know all these concepts, shear force, how to draw a shear force diagram and bending moment diagram, you have learned in your third semester. Mark the reference lines like this. Then take the datum. You all know above the datum the forces are positive, below the datum the forces are negative. So at this datum line the value is 0. Starting from 0, RA, the value of RA is 30, this is positive 30, therefore move to upside, and this 30 is constant till point P. So till point we don't have any loading variation, therefore this is constant. And at P we have 60 kilonewton acting downward, plus 30 minus 60 will leads us to minus 30. Again, this minus 30 is constant till B, because till B we don't have any forces. Therefore, this is minus 30. And at B, see, at B we have two reactions, RBA and RBC. RBA is 30 and RBC is 37.5. Therefore, RB equals to 67.5 kilonewton. Therefore, minus 30 plus 67.5 gives us plus 37.5. Therefore, we should move up to plus 37.5 kilonewton. Then, between B and C, we have UDL variation. Plus 37.5 minus, it is acting in downward, minus 10 into 6, it is 60. 37.5 minus 60 leads to minus 22.5. And you all know the variation of shear force diagram when we have UDL, it is linear. It is minus 22.5 kilonewton. We have minus 22.5 here, and the value of RC is plus 22.5. Minus 22.5 plus 22.5 gives us 0. Shear force diagram is a loop. We start with 0 and we should end at 0. Above the datum it is positive, below the datum it is negative. So this is called shear force diagram. This is how we need to sketch the SFD. And coming to the last point, that is BMD. See, I have defined points called P, and after sketching shear force diagram, if we get any zero shear force point, we have to take that. We should mark this zero shear force point onto the given structure. I'll call this as X, clear? And I take this distance as small x. We should find this distance to get the moment about X, because we don't know at which point the shear force is getting zero, clear? So now at P, we can take the moment. Since P is at the defined position, either take moment to the left hand side or to the right hand side. I'll take moment to the left hand side. So MP equals to RA into 3, positive, 45 is acting in downward direction, therefore minus 45, that equals to 45 kilonewton meter. Now to find this X, we know that, look here, we need to find the X point here, the distance at which position the shear force is getting zero. So to find that, we know shear force at X equals to zero. To the left hand side, I should take all the shear forces. If you refer this diagram, free body diagram, to the left hand side, I have RBC upward, therefore positive. Then 10 into X, which is acting in downward, therefore negative. This equals to 0. The value of RBC, you know, it is 37.5. So if you solve this equation, you'll get the value for X as 3.75 meters. Now take moment about X. So what is the moment about x? Again, I am going to take moment to the left hand side. Upward moments positive, downward moments negative. RBC into x minus 45 minus 10 into x by 2. And if you solve this, you know the value of RBC and you know the value of x. Substitute the respective values, and if you solve, get the moment value at x as 25.312 kilonewton meters. Clear? So after calculating the moments at defined points, now you can easily draw the bending moment diagram. As usual, take the datum. While sketching bending moment, we have two categories, span moments and end moments. End moments are MAB, MBA, MBC and MCB, and span moments are the moments we have calculated just now at point P and at point X. Clear? So now let us mark this. 45 is acting in downward direction. Therefore, I mark the value 45 to the downward zone. Again, this 45 also acting in downward direction. Therefore, show that 45 in the negative zone. And here we have 0. So these are the end moments. Now we mark the span moments. Moment at P is 45 and it is positive. I've already told above the datum is positive, below the datum is negative. Therefore, it is 45 kilonewton meter. And at X, clear? So we got this X as 3.375 meters. And at this point, we have got the moment as 25.312. Again, that is also positive. Therefore, we should mark that value above the datum line. 25.312 kilonewton meter. Join all these points based on the loading variation. You all know in bending moment diagram, if you get point load, the variation will be linear, and if you have UDL, the variation will be parabola. Just join all these points, starting from this zero reference, come downward, then this is a zone of point load. Therefore, I'll join all these points linearly. And in the zone of UDL, join all these points in the parabolic manner. Above the datum, it is positive. Below the datum, it is negative. So this is BMD. Yeah. So this completes problem number 1. So in flexibility matrix method, we should follow these simple 4 steps to solve any given problem. Let us meet in the next session. Thank you.